Okay, good evening, everyone. My name is Robert Fowler. I'm the president of the Hellenic Society, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you here this evening and to congratulate you on having managed to make your way through the obstacles posed by Storm Doris. What I would proceed to do now would be to introduce the speaker, but the speaker is also a victim of the storm. I was trying to get from Cambridge, no trains, took to his car, having waited at the station for a long time, but could get no further than 10 miles from Cambridge when he had to admit defeat. However, we have his slides, and his text is being printed as we speak. It should appear here momentarily. And if you can stand it, I will then attempt to impersonate Professor Whitmarsh so that you will get the talk that you came to hear and not some other spurious interloper. Well, I shall introduce him anyway in his absence. Tim is an extremely eminent scholar. He is the A.G. Leventis Professor of Greek Culture at the University of Cambridge. Before that, he had professorial appointments at Exeter and at Oxford. He covers an enormous range in his interests, but perhaps the focus of much of what he's done is in the period commonly called the Second Sophistic, 2nd century AD, Greek literature under the Roman Empire. And there he's produced a great many works of really fundamental importance. He's changed the way we think about that whole period of Greek history, indeed, and Greek literature. And indeed, he's one of the people who's brought it back into the center of attention, having languished on the periphery for decades. So he's written on the Greek novel. He's written on the many writers of the Second Sophistic. Most recently, he's written a book beyond the Second Sophistic. He's called it Adventures in Greek Post-Classicism, and he is the professor of Greek culture, so he looks at the whole tradition from the beginning to the end of antiquity and beyond. And he's also written on earlier periods of Greek literature and history. He's also the author of a very interesting book called Battles with the Gods, Atheism in the Ancient World. Tonight he's going back to ancient Athens, but much of what he is drawing on, I believe, if I can anticipate what he's going to say, will come from writers of a slightly later period, but it goes back to the classic gymnasium of Cynosarges, and the reports that this was a place where you would particularly find the nothoi, the bastards, the illegitimate sons of the aristocracy doing their exercises. So that's the general subject, and I look forward very much to hearing about this. I am now Professor Whitmarsh. I know it's a stretch. Here we go. The Bastards of the Cynosarges and the Invention of Virtue. I have elected to give you a rather elliptical title because this paper is a journey. It has a starting point and a destination, and I hope once we reach the latter, everything will become clear. But since we are only now at the starting point, I hope you will accept that the buildings in the distance, the Bastards of Cynosarges and the Invention of Virtue, will come into focus only as we get closer to them. My topic is the public gymnasia in the city of Athens, those spaces where the body was exercised, but also, crucially for my purposes, where philosophy was practiced. I want to think about these places within the topography of ancient Athens. What was it like to leave the city walls and go to study with Plato in the Academy, or with Aristotle in the Lyceum, or indeed to visit the now lesser known philosopher Antisthenes in the now lesser known Cynosarges? For these three spaces, the Academy, the Lyceum, and the Cynosarges, were the city's gymnasia. I will, in fact, have less to say about the Lyceum, which was founded a little later. I am more interested in the Academy and the Cynosarges, both of which philosophical complexes were, in a sense, contemporary rivals for the stewardship of Socrates' legacy. What was the journey like? What kinds of things did one see on the way? What did the space feel like? What kind of sensory and emotional journey was this? For space is not just physical. It has emotional and cognitive associations too. Adjacency suggests symbolic connections in people's minds. Would you want to be admitted to a hospital positioned next to a crematorium? Would you buy baby clothes next door to an adult movie cinema? Would you rather your house were next to a shop selling reptiles or a shop selling soft furnishings? Such juxtapositions are felt strongly by users of civic space. Ultimately, what I really want to know is how such journeys through the ancient city shaped the habits of thinking of ancient philosophers and their students. The city's three public gymnasia, the Academy, the Lyceum, and the Cynosarges, stood outside the Themistoclean walls in large, flat suburban areas with plentiful water supplies. The Academy lay six stades, about a kilometer, northwest of the walls, leaving through the Dipolon Gate in the Ceramicus. The Lyceum and the Cynosarges were in the opposite direction in the southeast, close to each other on either side of the banks of the river Ilissos. Can we pick the Academy out there? My laser is not working. Northwest of the city for the Academy and southeast of the Themistoclean walls for the other two. The Lyceum was accessed through the Diachares Gate, number 8 on this map. And the Cynosarges through the Diomaian Gate, number 11 here, next to the Kareroi Spring, number 155 on the map. I should say that while the Academy and the Lyceum have been well excavated, the exact location of the Cynosarges is disputed and its remains lie hidden beneath the modern city, although the general area is known from literary sources. Let us begin with Plato's Academy. Luckily, we have a guide. At some point in 79 to 78 BCE, Cicero was studying in Athens. At the start of the fifth book of his De Finibus, he records taking a stroll out to the Academy. Once I had been attending the Ethics of Antiochus, a lecture of Antiochus, as I was in the habit of doing with Marcus Piso in the building called the School of Ptolemy, and Tim comments, which is unknown, at least to me. And with us were my brother Quintus, Titus Pomponius, and Lucius Cicero, whom I loved as a brother, but who was really my first cousin. We arranged to take our afternoon stroll in the Academy, chiefly because the place would be quiet and deserted at that hour of the day. Accordingly, at the time appointed, we met at our rendezvous, Piso's lodgings, and starting out, beguiled with conversation on various subjects, the 3/4 of a mile from the Dipolon Gate. When we reached the walks of the Academy, which are so deservedly famous, we had them entirely to ourselves, as we had hoped. Luckily, we know exactly where the Dipolon Gate is. In the aftermath of the Persian invasion of Greece, Athens built huge, thick defensive walls, completed in the 470s BCE, the so-called Themistoclean walls, which were an estimated 6.5 kilometers long, 8 to 10 meters tall, and 3 meters wide. Parts of these still survived. They are best preserved in the Ceramicus, the ceramic quarter, in the southwest of the city, where there is now a nice archaeological site and museum. The Dipolon was a massive fortified gateway and holding area that provided the main entrance into the city. It too lies in the Ceramicus archaeological site, and parts of it survive. Here is a photo I took last summer. You can see what an impressive structure it was. Literally, the Dipolon is a double gate with two chambers that could be sealed separately for defensive purposes. This points to its crucial role as a main thoroughfare. The road that Cicero took, however, was not a particularly major one, though it was well paved for the benefit of travelers. This map is not, in fact, a particularly good one of the city, but it does help you visualize where the Ceramicus and the Dipolon are in relation to the rest of the city. You can actually retrace Cicero's journey in the modern city. Cicero must have walked along the road known as the Dromos, the central of the three forks leading out of the Dipolon. To do this nowadays, you have to pay your €8 to go into the Ceramicus archaeological site, well worth it, and start at the Dipolon. You then walk northwest to the perimeter of the site down this avenue. Then you either have to climb over the perimeter fence of the archaeological site, not advisable, or, as I did, cheat a little, go out of the site via the official exit and walk around to pick up the route on the other side. Then you walk down the modern Platon Street, named after the Battle of Plataea, not Plato. After a while, Platon forks, the left-hand branch becoming Monasteriu, and the right, Platonos, which this time does mean Plato Street. On this map, you would be walking from the bottom right of Platon till it crosses the Leophoros Athenon, where it splits. Both routes take you to the archaeological site of the ancient academy, but if you want the authentic Ciceronian experience, you want to take Monasteriu. En route, in the square called Academia Platonos Square, in the pedestrianized bit at the top of the map, north of Palamidiu, which confusingly is not the site of the actual academy, but rather on the way, you can pause to look at the remains of an ancient road, which presumably is the Dromos and the very road that Cicero took. Continuing along Monasteriu takes you to the ancient gymnasium complex, where a number of foundations survive, and even the site of the palaestra, or wrestling area. To the east of this complex, buildings have been excavated that can tentatively be identified with Plato's school. Now you may be thinking, this is a pleasant afternoon stroll for a romantic recreation of Cicero's walk, but what does it tell us about anything? At this point, we need to turn to a different guide, who will tell us what we find along the way. Pausanias was antiquity's premier travel writer, who roamed around the Greek mainland in the 2nd century CE, describing what he encountered en route. Pausanias is a better guide than Cicero to topographic feel. He is interested in the emotional texture of landscape, in the juxtapositions between buildings and monuments and their effects, whether consonant or dissonant. Pausanias' journey is structured around the three great monumental sites of Greece, Athens, Olympia, and Delphi, which occupy respectively the beginning, the middle, and the end sections of his account. Now, Pausanias was writing half a millennium later than Plato's time, and we know for sure that the built environment of Athens was very different in Pausanias' day. The Roman general Sulla had captured Athens in 87 to 86 and devastated its material fabric, including that of the Academy and the Dipolon area. This devastation occurred some 8 years before the walk that Cicero described. It is striking and in a way telling that the Roman tourist neglects to mention the havoc caused by a Roman invasionary force. When Cicero writes that we had the Academy to ourselves, there is a grim irony at work, given the depopulation that must have followed Sulla's sack. By Pausanias' time, however, in the 2nd century CE, the Emperor Hadrian had invested in a lot of rebuilding, including, again, in the Dipolon area. But of course, rebuilding doesn't mean restoration, it means rebranding. Hadrian was reinventing the city as a monument to his own Philhellenism. A famous inscription survives from the Arch of Hadrian in the area of the temple to Olympian Zeus in the southeast. One side of it, facing towards the Acropolis, identifies, quote, the ancient city of Theseus, while the other, facing outwards, speaks of, quote, the city of Hadrian and not of Theseus, end quote. So we have to use Pausanias with a lot of care. He is not in any sense a straightforward witness to the city of the 4th century BCE. But with that preamble over, let's have a look and see what he says when he leaves via the Dipolon Gate and walks outside the city towards the Academy, following in Cicero's footsteps. And he says, by way of introduction to this slide, I haven't given you the whole of this quotation, just a flavor. Outside the city too, in the parishes and on the roads, The Athenians have sanctuaries of the gods and graves of heroes and of men. The nearest is the academy, once the property of a private individual, but in my time, a gymnasium. Such are their sanctuaries here, and of the graves, the first is that of Thrasybulus, son of Lycos, in all respects, the greatest of all famous Athenians, whether they lived before him or after him. Comment, Pausanias now expatiates a little on Thrasybulus, an anti-tyrannical revolutionary of the late 5th century BCE. Quotation continues. His is the first grave, and after it come those of Pericles, Chabrios, and Phormio. There is also a monument for all the Athenians whose fate it has been to fall in battle, whether at sea or on land, except such of them as fought at Marathon. These, for their valor, have their graves on the field of battle, but the others lie along the road to the academy, and on their graves stand slabs bearing the name and parish of each. What does this tell us? Well, most of all, it tells us that the dromos was full of markers of death and commemoration. The Keramikos, where the dromos began at the Dipolon, was Athens's burial site. So the minute you began on the dromos, most of your companions were underground. The Keramikos has been well excavated, and you can see many of the monuments in the museum attached to the site. This was also the spot where, in the age of the classical democracy, one of the civic leaders would give an annual funeral speech celebrating those who had died in war. Pausanias shows us that the memorials continued right up until the academy, at least in his day, but the monuments he describes do sound as if they may have been much older. This fact would not be known to us without Pausanias, since the latter part of the dromos, up to the academy, is residential and has not been explored archaeologically. The concentration of memorials puts an interesting complexion on Cicero's comment on the quiet of the academy. We had it to ourselves. Was this perhaps an eerie quiet, the silence of the dead? And what was our Roman tourist thinking as he walked along a road lined with monuments to the Athenians' heroic resistance to the Persian invasions? Did it occur to him that his compatriot Sulla was, in the eyes of the Athenians, just such an invader, but a successful one, who inflicted devastation and plunder on the city in the way that the Persians had failed to do? The deathliness of the place survives now only in macabre street art, not to be sure limited to this part of Athens. But what does this tell us about Plato's philosophy? The crucial point in my view is that Plato's philosophy asserted that the soul was more important than the body, which was a mere case for it. The aim of the philosophical life was to shuck off the constraints of the material body, its appetites and desires, and focus instead on that immortal spark of divine fire that animates us. For Plato, death actually liberates the soul from the body, putting it in a state of greater philosophical purity. The very journey up the dromos enacted this process. As you walked out of the city, you were reminded of the transience and impermanence of the physical frame, of all those who had gone before, of how all that was left of them in our world were the memories of those who came after. But then you emerged at the other end of the dromos, in the academy. Which lay at the end of it in a lush, well-watered spot devoted to relaxation. The peacefulness that Cicero noted in the place could have had another meaning. The academy was a physical manifestation in the topography of Athens of the Platonic idea of death as the Irenic transcendence of the material body. Death is not the end, this journey tells us. Rather, it is the route to true philosophy. One other point before we leave Plato. At some point around 300 BCE, a rival philosopher, Epicurus, bought a plot of land and founded his famous garden. The garden was not really a school like the academy or the Lyceum. It was more a physical manifestation of the ideal of tranquil serenity at which his philosophy aimed. devoted both to enabling friendship between people of all backgrounds, including women and slaves, and to the commemoration of Epicurus himself. For most in antiquity, this place embodied Epicureanism more than anywhere else on earth. Where exactly it was is not certain. There is no archaeology to help us. But Cicero once again comes to our aid, since he tells us, just after the passage that we saw earlier, that once the party arrived at the academy, they entered into conversation. His brother Quintus says that they recently, modo, saw the village of Colonus. And the crucial part for our purposes, Pomponius mentions that they have recently, modo again, passed Epicurus's garden. The location of Colonus is certain. It is a hill to the east of the academy, where, according to modern Athenian tradition, Plato used to wander to look at the stars. And if we return to the modern map, we can see the park in the green space to the right. In the top right, whereas the academy is the larger green space to the left. The garden and the academy. Now, if Quintus says they recently saw Colonus, and Pomponius says they recently saw Epicurus's garden, using the same word for recently, that suggests that the garden became visible to them at approximately the same point on the walk as the hill of Colonus did. It is hard to be certain, but it looks as if Epicurus's garden lay somewhere just off the Dromos, between the Dipylon and the Academy. I was told by one modern Athenian that it lies just off the Leophoros Athenon flyover, a less serene spot in the modern city could scarcely be conceived of, although I suppose there is a bit of greenery. But the crucial point is that we are now in a position to begin to speculate about the symbolic associations that may have motivated Epicurus to put his garden where he did, or at least which may have occurred to ancient visitors. The Dromos was the road where Athenians collectively thought about death and commemoration. As we have seen, Plato's academy lay at the end of it as a reminder that death was not the end, that the decay of the physical body was the route to true tranquility. Epicurus's garden was surely positioned so as to hijack that topographical narrative. Rather than locating it at the end of the Dromos, beyond death, Epicurus placed his philosophical hub in the midst of it. The garden was surrounded by monuments to the fallen. This is interesting because death played a big role in Epicurean philosophy. One of his central tenets is that the constituent parts of everything are matter and void. There is no spirit, and so no survival after death, and just as importantly, no possibility of judgment in the afterlife. For Epicureans, this was a great source of comfort. This life is the only one we have, so there is no need to worry about pleasing or appeasing gods. That the garden was located in a space thick with material relics of the fragility of human life, and reminders that, from an Epicurean point of view, nothing survives death that is not made of physical and material things. Epicurus set himself directly against Plato, geographically as well as intellectually. He positioned his garden in a place that could have been designed specifically to interrupt the journey towards the academy and towards Platonism. The location could be seen as a kind of hijacking of the Dromos. Death leads nowhere for Epicurus, certainly not to some kind of idyllic beyond. The only way in which we survive death is by being materialized in the memories of successor generations. And that, I think, is why the garden was placed amid a forest of tombs and commemorations. But why did Plato choose the academy as the location for his school? The reason for that, I think, lies in a different kind of rivalry. Plato was not the first philosopher to set up shop in a gymnasium. Socrates himself had often frequented sports grounds, particularly wrestling grounds, palaestrae, where he found many lively young men possessed of the leisure necessary to engage in philosophical activity. But the first philosopher to fix himself to a particular gymnasium was apparently Antisthenes, who made the Cynosarges his own. Let us return to the map of Athens. I mentioned at the start that the Cynosarges is on the opposite side of the city from the academy. That, I think, is a significant point. Plato wanted, I suspect, to be as far away as possible from his rival to the mantle of Socrates' successor. What he was attempting was a very different kind of philosophical project, in fact, practically the polar opposite, and the physical location of his school expressed that in topographical terms. So who was Antisthenes? Unlike Plato, he has left us very little in his own words, although we have numerous references to him. Among these are a number of fragments that attest to his simultaneous closeness to and rivalry with Plato. Here is a flavor. "And he used to taunt Plato with being conceited. At all events, when in a procession he spied a spirited charger, he said, turning to Plato, 'It seems to me that you would have made just such a proud, showy steed.' This because Plato was constantly praising horseflesh. And one day he visited Plato, who was ill, and seeing the basin into which Plato had vomited, remarked, 'The bile I see, but not the pride.'" From Diogenes Laertius, his Lives of the Philosophers, Book 6. Whatever the authenticity of anecdotes like this, they suggest that at least in the minds of the ancients, Plato and Antisthenes were like quarreling brothers, often by each other's sides, often visiting each other, but never missing an opportunity to put the other down. Why did Antisthenes choose the Cynosarges to teach in? Here we are on sure ground, at one level, because this particular gymnasium had a very distinctive role in Athenian life. In 451 to 450, Pericles enacted his famous citizenship law, ensuring that, quote, only those who could claim Athenian parentage on both sides should be counted as Athenian. That from Plutarch's Life of Pericles. This was apparently the point at which the myth of autochthony gained its hold on the Athenian imagination. According to this story, the first Athenian, Erechtheus or Erechthonius, was born from the soil of Athens, born of Hephaestus's misdirected semen when pursuing the goddess Athena. The present-day Athenians, then, were direct, genetic descendants of the city's founder, a pure people with an unbroken link to the territory of Attica. The myth of autochthony and the citizenship law, have been widely discussed. Let me highlight just three of its important effects. The first is that autochthony was held to distinguish the Athenians from other Greeks like the Spartans, who believed that they had invaded and occupied their territory. These could be dismissed as either intruders, epeludes, or mixed race, migades. Secondly, the law led to a demonization of adultery, and hence of sexually active women, which was seen as a threat not just to public morality, but also to the integrity of the Athenian race. If a woman was having sex with a man who was not her husband, how could he be sure that his offspring were genuine Athenian citizens? This led to a kind of slipperiness about ideas of legitimacy and bastardy. There is, of course, a sharp difference between sex between unmarried people of the same race and sex between married people of different races. In the first case, the offspring would have been called illegitimate until fairly recently, whereas the question of the racial origin of a married couple is strictly irrelevant to the question of the legitimacy of their children, although in many societies there may be all sorts of complications. But in Athens, the two became blurred. A legitimate gynaeseos, or upright-born ithagenes Athenian, had to be born both within marriage and within the kinship group. If either of those conditions was not met, i.e., if the child was either born of a relationship between two unmarried people or was generated by one parent outside the kinship group, then that child was a bastard, nothos. Now, the reasons for Pericles' citizenship law have been widely debated and need not occupy us now. The important point is their effect, which was to delegitimize instantaneously a band of people who had been Athenian citizens. These were now branded bastards, even if their parents were married. This group included some pretty powerful people, for it was in particular the super rich who had the means to meet people from outside the city and the will to forge strategic dynastic alliances with them. This indeed may have been part of Pericles' motivation. The gymnasium at Cynosarges, we are told by a number of ancient sources, was made over to these bastards, a point that Sally Humphreys in particular has emphasized. We are told by the lexicographer of the 2nd century CE, Pausanias the Atticist, to be distinguished from the travel writer we met earlier, that the sanctuary was founded by Heracles and named after a pale or a quick dog, Apakunus, Kunos Argu, whom he caught there. As a result, the bastards, Nothoi, are enrolled there because Heracles too, though a bastard, was honored as much as the gods. Plutarch similarly tells us that Themistocles too used to exercise there because his mother was not Athenian, although this will have been before Pericles' law. He preferred the gymnasium of Heracles, we are told, for he too was not a legitimate god, but had something alien about him from the fact that his mother was a mortal. To describe Heracles as a bastard may be a very strange thing to say at one level, but we do have clear parallels from classical Athenian sources like Aristophanes' Birds. It seems undeniable then that Heracles, of mixed divine and human parentage, was held up by the bastards as a model for emulation. Despite the disadvantages of his birth, Heracles had triumphed through fortitude and labor. He had become godlike. Cynosarges was imagined as a place where the disadvantages of birth could be compensated for by a virtuous behavior. When you went to the Cynosarges area, you were going to a place of masculine striving and endeavor. You had passed the mighty temple of Olympian Zeus built by the Pisistratids, but never completed, number 158 on the map. You could see the larger gymnasium complex of the Lyceum, and in particular, you could see the huge stadium. But in fact, you had left the city by a different gate to those visiting the Lyceum. And that fact of leaving the city walls and crossing over the river Ilissos, river crossings always suggest movement beyond boundaries, would have given the impression that you were going into a different world. You could still see the Acropolis behind you, and when it was built, the Parthenon. But you are now in a different zone of the city, overseen by Heracles, the bastard god who nevertheless did his father, Olympian Zeus, whose temple you probably could also see, proud. Now, Antisthenes was also a Mitroxenos. A bastard on his mother's side. Antisthenes, the son of Antisthenes, was an Athenian. It was said, however, that he was not of pure Attic blood. Hence his reply to one who taunted him with this, "The mother of the gods, too, is a Phrygian." For his mother was supposed to have been a Thracian. Hence it was that when he had distinguished himself in the Battle of Tanagra, he gave Socrates occasion to remark that if both his parents had been Athenians, he would not have turned out so brave. He himself showed his contempt for the airs which the Athenians gave themselves on the strength of being sprung from the soil by the remark that this did not make them any better born than snails or wingless locusts. Our friend Diogenes again. Antisthenes was thus not just a bastard, he was an active opponent of the Athenian ideology of good birth. The point of the final quoted part is that the Greeks thought that snails and locusts and occasionally other small animals like mice and frogs were born not from sexual reproduction but out of cavities in the ground. In other words, he says, better to be a bastard than an autochthonous Greek. This is the point also about his virtuous behavior at the Battle of Tanagra. He fought better, Socrates says, than he would have done had he been a true-born Athenian. This is what I mean when I speak of the invention of virtue. Antisthenes and his school made a great play of the idea of virtue, arete, which they imagined as a form of moral fortitude displayed in the face of life's vicissitudes. It was, at one level, a metaphor drawn from the world of athletics. Certainly the word in Homer always has connotations of strength, vigor, and manly heroism. But Antisthenes and his followers transferred it onto all areas of life so that it became a moral quality that anyone could display in any activity. In particular, it was a polemical concept in a double sense. Firstly, to display virtue, you needed challenges to overcome. This is why Antisthenes put much emphasis on the idea of labor, ponos, a property, of course, of Heracles, the overcomer of labors par excellence. But the idea of virtue was polemical also at a more abstract level because it was competing with the model of innate quality. The mainstream Athenian idea of good birth, eugeneia, was based around a concept of racial purity. The more Athenian you had in you as a result of your parentage, the better you were as a person. Antisthenes' argument was precisely the opposite. Virtue, he insisted repeatedly, was teachable. Favorite themes with him were the following. He would prove that virtue can be taught, that nobility belongs to none other than the virtuous. This theme comes first in his list, and it is fair to assume that it was the most important one for him. Virtue is teachable. It is not innate, but can be trained by discipline. Virtue is not an abstract quality for Antisthenes, some property that we possess inside us. It consists solely in the habit of performing good deeds, and we are all capable of that, irrespective of the circumstances of our birth. In fact, the translation, which is from the Lloyd, I have given you for the final sentence is a little misleading. What the Greek says is, the possessors of virtue are identical with the eugenes. Tous autos eugenes, tous kai eretus. The last word, eugenes, is very pointed. This is what the Athenians called themselves, noble, because they had imagined themselves to be inheritors of a pure bloodline that gave them their virtue. Antisthenes, Heraclean philosopher, was designed first and foremost to resist that. But when you left the city via the Diomean gate and crossed the Ilissos, then you entered a kind of para-Athens with its own anti-Periclean message. This was a place where moral qualities were displayed through practice and hard work, where the labor of philosophy was celebrated. No wonder Plato founded his school at the other extreme of Athens. Plato was an innatist, an essentialist. His dialogue, Meno, is designed to prove that virtue is intrinsic to the individual and cannot be taught. Plato thought that even knowledge is within us already. All we need to do is to remember it. There is no need for labors and trials within this world. In fact, our primary duty is to prepare ourselves to escape from it. I am not arguing that topography fully explains all of the dimensions of Greek philosophy, of course not, but I do think that understanding how the city of Athens was laid out helps us to appreciate better the feel of the different philosophies being founded in the late classical period. Most people in this period encountered philosophy not in deracinated books, but in physical settings expounded by real people. I am convinced that these locations must have added textures and nuances to the teachings of the philosophers. And even if we nowadays have to work hard to recover some of these, that is, I hope, a labor that is valuable and carries with it a kind of virtue of its own. Thank you very much.